Okay, so I'm starting. So thank you for the introduction. And let's start with an example voting. So you have n parties, P1, Pn, who want to vote electronically. Each party Pi has a vote Xi, so think of Xi as a bit, for example, 0 for no, 1 for yes. And each party want to send a single message to an electronic ballot box or to a server called an evaluator, which should then be able to compute the result of the vote, namely the majority of all the inputs. So I won't elaborate on this a lot, but in that setting, you need a trusted setup. And we will suppose we have a trusted party, which will generate a correlated randomness for all the parties. So more precisely, the trusted party will give to each party PI two messages, one called MI0, one MI1, corresponding to the two possible input bits of the party. And then the protocol will just consist for each party PI to send the message corresponding to its input XI, so the message MIXI. And from all these messages, the evaluator should be able to compute the majority of the bits. So this kind of protocol is modeled by a private simultaneous messages protocol, or PSM for short, and this has been introduced by Feige, Killian, and Naor, and Ishai Kushilevitz. So obviously in that case, in that general model, you consider, instead of considering voting as a function, you consider a general function f. And you suppose that the evaluator is honest but curious. So the security you want to achieve is that the evaluator learns nothing except what he's supposed to output, namely the evaluation of the function on x1, xn. So this is an interesting model already, but there are some, I mean, it's kind of weak because it does not provide any guarantee if one of the party, PI, is colluding with the evaluator and, for example, is giving its correlated randomness or it, both its message, MI0 and MI1. So let's suppose, for example, that P1 colludes with the evaluator. In that case, clearly, P1 and the evaluator can evaluate the function on both F0, X2, Xn, and F1, X2, Xn. This is due to the fact that the protocol is completely non-interactive. But what Bemmel et al. Introduced in 2014 is the notion of robust non-interactive multiparty computation, which says that in such a setting, the colluding parties and the evaluator should not learn more than these values that they can learn just by naively applying the protocol. And by the way, these values are called the residual function for the colluding parties. So more formally, what we want is the following security property. We want T-robustness. T-robustness says that the protocol is secure even if at most T parties are colluding with the evaluator. And the T party and the evaluator should not learn more than the residual function. So if you look at the notion of zero robustness, actually it just corresponds to the original notion I talked to you about, PSM. Because in zero robustness, you suppose that there is no collusion at all, just the evaluator is honest but curious. So to understand better what's going on, let's start with to show how to construct a simple PSM protocol using garbage circuits. And then we show that, unfortunately, this protocol, as most PSM protocols, are actually not secure against even a single collusion. So let's look at this construction. So you have a circuit, and the trusted party, the first thing it will associate to each wire of the circuit two values called labels. And it will give to party PI the two values corresponding to its two wires. So each value, one value corresponds to the bit 0 on the wire, and the other value corresponds to the bit 1 on the wire. And the protocol will work as follows. Each party will send to the evaluator the value or the label corresponding to its input. So here, P1 and M11. And then the evaluator will take all these values and evaluate the circuit in an encrypted way using some additional information generated by the trusted parties, which consist of ciphertext, and which are called usually garbled gates. Okay, so concretely, for this gate, blue gate here, the evaluator will have access to these four ciphertexts, and using the two labels he got from party P1 and P2, he will be able to recover, to decrypt, I mean, this row of the table, and to recover the label for corresponding to the output of the gate. So here it's labeled MA1, 1 because 1 and 1 is equal to 1. This is an AND gate, if you don't know. And then the evaluator can do the same here, and then he can do the same for this XOR gate. And at the end, he gets the label of the output wire, and he has some, again, additional information which associate to the label of the output wire the actual output of the circuit. So this way, the evaluator learns nothing but the output of the circuit. But it's only assuming there is no collusion. It's only a PSM. As soon as one party is allowed to collude with the evaluator, nothing works anymore. So let's look at this example again. And let's suppose that P2 is colluding with the evaluator. So in that case, you can see that normally, the evaluator together with P2 should not be able to learn more than X1, XOR, X3. Because when X2 equals 0, then you get zero, always the 0 output. And when X2 equals 1, you get X1, XOR, F3. So that's the only thing the evaluator should learn. Unfortunately, he can learn much more. Because what he can do is use the input label for X2 equals 1 for the left AND gate, and use the input label for X2 equals 0 for the right AND gate. And that way, if you evaluate the circuit now honestly, as before, what it will end up with is X1, which is something you should not learn at all. So let's step back a little bit and actually look at what is known about this PSM and this NIMPC protocol. So in the PSM setting, as we have just seen, if you are willing to assume one function, you can do this garbled circuit trick and get a construction for any polynomial trust circuit. If you don't want to assume any assumption, if you want to be information theoretic, we know how to do PSM for a branching program, so basically log space, and for some strand languages like quadratic residuosity, and otherwise it's a completely open question. We won't be able to do anything here in this paper. On the other hand, for NIMPC, as you may guess, you have way fewer construction. So first, if you want to allow collusion of polynomial size, the only construction we know is a construction for iterative group products, which is like a kind of weird language, maybe. And the worst of it is that Goldwasser et al. And Bemer et al. Showed a really strong impossibility result. Namely, if you can do an NIMPC for robust against a polynomial size collusion, then if you can do it for any circuit, for the universal circuit in particular, then you can get I/O. And if you can just do it for CNF, which is a very, very, very weak class of function, you already get witness encryption. So there is not much hope here to construct an NIMPC secure against polynomial size collusion under weak assumptions such as one-way function or public key encryption. The worst of it is that even for an NIMPC robust against constant size collusion, we don't know much. Okay, we know this iterative group product, and the only other construction we know is for abelian programs, which are basically symmetric generalization of symmetric functions. So there is a huge gap between constantly robust and NIMPC, which can do basically symmetric function, and PSM, which can do log space information theoretically and any polynomial size circuit computationally. And in this paper, we bridge the gap between these two things. We show that take any PSM, or an NIMPC secure against no collusion, then you can transform it into an NIMPC, which is secure against constant size collusion for the same function. And the transformation is information theoretic. So we don't need any assumption. So if you started from a PSM which is information theoretic, you end up with an NIMPC which is information theoretic. And in particular, we saw basically information theoretic constantly robust NIMPC for log space and computationally secure constantly robust NIMPC for P, using just by combining this transformation with the previous construction. So we also have a side result about symmetric function, but we won't have time to talk about that. Okay, so let's now look at this transformation. So recall, you want to transform a PSM for some function and to make it secure against a constant size collusion. So in this talk, I will really try to simplify as much as possible the construction. So I will only consider PSM constructed from garbled circuit, so the kind of PSM you've seen at the beginning, and I will only consider collusion of size one. You just want to make it secure against one user, one player colluding with the evaluator. But as we have seen, even in that case, we don't know much. I mean, we know that the issue is that it's not secure because if the evaluator learns two labels for the same input wire, then he can use these two labels to learn too much information. So what we want is that we want to prevent the evaluator to learn two labels for the same garbled circuit and the same input. So here is the original PSM, and here is our idea. Instead of using only one copy of the garbled circuit, you will use two copies of the garbled circuit. So the garbled circuit is here. One name sigma equals zero, one index sigma equal one. And what we want is that if P1, for example, is colluding with the evaluator, when P1 and the evaluator try to do things, try to evaluate things using x1 equals zero, the only thing they can do is use the first garbled circuit. One of the two garbled circuits, but not both. And we want that when they try to do things or evaluate the circuit with x1 equal one, the only thing they will be able to evaluate is the other garbled circuit. So that they will never know both input labels for the same input and the same garbled circuit. It will be a different garbled circuit for each value of x1. But the issue is, how can you select the garbled circuit which you will be able to evaluate? Because if you know that P1 is colluding with the evaluator, that's easy. You say that the only circuit they are able to evaluate is, for example, the circuit of index x1. And that satisfies the property. But if you don't know in advance who is colluding with the evaluator, you need to dynamically select the garbled circuit. And in case of one collusion, there is a nice way of doing it, which is just to take the parity of all the inputs. So the circuit that the evaluator and the colluding parties will be able to evaluate is the circuit corresponding to the parity of all the inputs. But here's a small issue, is that how do the evaluator, learn the input label for the correct circuit? We remark that obviously you cannot give all the input label for both circuits to all parties, otherwise we are just stuck at, we go back to the beginning and it's even worse than before. You just double the size of everything and you don't have much more security. So what we do is we combine these two garbled circuits with n new robust, one robust NIMPC, which will be used to output the input labels that the evaluator and possibly the colluding parties are allowed to see. So more precisely, so this NIMPC are called selector, and each party, the trusted party will generate the correlated randomness for all this thing, and will give to P1, for example, the correlated randomness corresponding to the input one in all the selectors. And then when running the protocol, P1 will just send all the message corresponding to all the selector for its input bit. And then the evaluator will evaluate the selectors, get the input labels for all the input of one of the two garbled circuits, and then evaluate the corresponding garbled circuit and get the final output. The subtle point is that if P1 collude with the evaluator, if he try to cheat the selectors, for example, if you try to use x1 equals 0 for the first sector, x1 equals 2 for the other sector, it won't be useful at all, because in that case, it will learn one input label for one garbled circuit and another input label for another garbled circuit. So it's completely useless for him. So the only thing P1 and the evaluator can do is to evaluate everything honestly using either x1 equals 0, in which case they get, say, the whole set of input label for garbled circuit 0, or evaluate everything using x1 equal 1, in which case they get the whole set of input label for the other circuit. And basically, they will only learn f0 x2 x1 and f1 x2 x1, which is a residual function, and that you cannot prevent them to learn, but that's the only thing they should learn. So that's perfect. Okay, so it remains to construct these selectors. So I said we need one robust NIMPC for this selector. So you may think we kind of went nowhere because we already wanted to construct one robust NIMPC at the beginning. But the point is, the selector are really simple functions. They only output a message, like using some, depending on some linear relations. That's something which is really, really simple. And actually, we show in our paper how to construct this information theoretically using SPAN program and linear algebra. In this talk, I won't have time to talk about this construction. It's a bit technical. I will show you a simplified Diop-Bayes construction, which requires one-way function. But keep in mind that we don't need at all one-way function in our real transformation. So here is the selector. So how do we construct a selector for this one robust case? And let's say selector for the first input label, cell one. So we will first construct this circuit. This circuit outputs two things. It outputs a pair, x1 and sigma, which is the parity of all the inputs. It uses this weird gate, but don't worry. And then what you will do is the following. More precisely, what the trusted party will do is the following. It will garble this circuit, and instead of giving classically the association of each output label with the output of the circuit, it won't do that at all. Instead, it will publish an encryption of the input label that the evaluator should learn depending on the output wire. So for example, if x1 equals 0 and sigma equals 0, the evaluator will learn this output label and will learn input label corresponding to x1 equals 0 for the circuit sigma equals 0, and so on. So this way, the evaluator will learn exactly the requested label. So if you follow the talk, you may see that I'm cheating completely here because I'm using your garbled circuit, and I've just said that your garbled circuit is not secure against collusion. But the point is, this garbled circuit is really, really simple again. So first, each input is only used once, and second, all the gates are linear. And in that specific case, you are secure, actually. Okay. So we have seen the construction for one robustness, security against collusion of single party. Let's show how to extend it to constant size robustness. So here you will need more than two garbled circuits. You will need more than that, and you will need a smarter way to select which garbled circuit will be evaluated. So previously you just took the parity. Now you will use a code, actually the syndrome of a code. And if the code has some minimum distance, reasonable minimum distance, actually at least t plus one, then you're good. And if you use a Ritz-Solomon code, we can show that the resulting T-robust NIMPC protocol will have complexity, basically 2n to the t times the complexity of the original PSM. So that's where the constant thing comes into play, because here you're exponential in t, so you need t to be constant, otherwise you have exponential size. And we have a bad news is that we cannot extend our technique to do better than constant size collusion. We have this lower bound, which is due to sphere packing, and it's hard to avoid. Okay, so to conclude, our main result is a transformation of any PSM, which is a weak model for which we know a lot of construction, into a constantly robust NIMBC for which we knew basically almost nothing, I mean, basically except symmetric function and iterative group product. And we also have a side result about symmetric function, but still we don't manage to go beyond constant size collusion. So this talk is really just constant size collusion. Okay, thank you for your attention.